goal of any epidemiological study is to acquire an accurate picture of a disease. Epidemiological studies are used to first determine the frequency of specific health problems, identify patterns and occurrence of disease, identify any potential cases and risk factors, and to evaluate the efficacy of the preventive measures and treatments. The information obtained is used to create strategies for prevention and treatment of animal health conditions, preserve public health, implement better policies, and so on. Epidemiological research is always conducted at the level of population. What kind of population is that? It might be consist of animals, herds, villages, farms, regions, and so on. Basically, there are two main reasons why an epidemiologist performs population level research, and most often it's not the whole population, but just fraction or sample of the population. First is to quantify the characteristic of that population, for example, the prevalence of a disease. This type of search, the research is known as a descriptive research, and it's often conducted using surveys. Secondly, the interest of the study might be testing of association between disease and exposure to a suspected causal factor. The main focus on such research is to test hypotheses, whether some risk factor is connected with the disease occurrence or not. This type of research is called analytical research. Both types are observational because the researcher observes events without intervention. The main focus of epidemiology research is to test the association between disease and exposure to a suspected causal factor in the population, to measure the association between disease and exposure, and to express the absolute or relative change in risk due to the exposure. In general, the risk is defined as a possibility of hazard, the bad consequences, loss, and so on. So whatever the type of the observational research is, the population is usually too large to allow observation of all animals. Moreover, estimation of association often can be obtained to acceptable degree of precision by selection of number of animals smaller than population size. The estimation of sample size will be explained later in the course. Although the survey could generally be classified as a study, it is excluded from the epidemiological studies because it missed the comparison and required analysis and involve only the description of information. There are four main types of epidemiological studies: experimental studies, cross-sectional studies, case control studies, and cohort studies. In an experimental study, the researcher has the ability to allocate animals to various groups according to factors which the researcher can randomly assign to animals. So the researcher has full control of the situation. So this might include disease occurrence in vaccinated and non-vaccinated animals, recovery rates on treated versus untreated animals, feed intake, production output parameter, and so on. Such studies are part of experimental epidemiology. Clinical trials are a good example of experimental epidemiology, where the researcher assigns animals either to a group which prophylactic or therapeutic procedures is applied, or to a control group which those procedures is not applied. The results of two groups then compared and analyzed in order to reject or accept the tested procedure. The other types of studies, cross-sectional, case control, and cohort, are observational studies. The observational study is similar with experimental study. Animals are allocated to different groups with respect to certain characteristics that they possess, like disease, breed, production type. However, in observational studies, it is not possible to assign animals to groups randomly because the researcher has little or no control over the factors that are being studied: sex, breed, age, weight. In other words, in field condition, the researcher cannot randomly assign different animals to different groups because simply the farmers will not allow that. Now, the first type of study is a cross-sectional study, which examines the relationship between the disease or other health state and other variables of interest as they exist in defined population and single point in time or over short period of time, most often calendar year. So you should think about the cross-sectional study as a snapshot from the camera. So we just make the shot of the current situation and then we analyze it. The cross-sectional studies are particularly useful for determining the prevalence of disease in the planning and allocation of animal resources. So on this picture is shown how the cross-sectional study exams. So the defining feature of the cross-sectional study is that compare a different population group at the single point of time. In simple words, the cross-sectional study provides a snapshot of the frequency of the disease in a population at given point of time. Cross-sectional studies can be descriptive or analytical. A cross-sectional study might be purely descriptive and used to assess the prevalence of particular disease in defined population. For example, a random sample of farms in Kakheti region may be used to assess the prevalence of mastitis among the cattle. Analytical cross-sectional studies aim to assess association between different parameters, for example, disease prevalence among vaccinated and not vaccinated animals. However, this type of study is limited in its ability to draw valid conclusions as to the association between risk factor and health outcome. In cross-sectional studies, the risk factors and the outcome are measured simultaneously, and therefore it may be difficult to determine whether the exposure proceeds or follows the disease. So let's give example with two farms with tuberculosis. So we make a snapshot, we discovered or we diagnosed that in one farm there is four cattle with out of 10 with diagnosis, and the other one have two out of 10 with tuberculosis. So we don't know when and which farm present the risk in the beginning, which farm was firstly affected and transferred the disease to the other farm, and which farm was exposed to the disease, because we make the snapshot at one point of time and we have no idea where the disease occurs first. The advantages of cross-sectional studies are: they are relatively quick and easy to conduct. They provide information of the prevalence among the studied population and provide information for descriptive analysis for generating the hypothesis. The disadvantages are that are difficult to determine whether the outcome followed the exposure in time or exposure resulted from the outcome, as we discussed about the tuberculosis farms. They are not suitable for studying disease with low prevalence or disease with short duration, because during the snapshot, those disease with low prevalence or short duration no longer exist. We are unable to measure the incidence, and association identified might be difficult to interpret. The second type are case control studies. They compare the prevalence of exposure to potential risk factors between causes or animal with disease and controls or animal without the disease. So it's important to know that the case control studies are always retrospective. A study starts at present time with the two group of animals, with and without the disease, and then compare the risk factor among them in the past. A major flow of case control studies are that the data on potential risk factors are collected retrospectively and as a result may give rise to a bias. This is a particular problem associated with the case control studies and therefore need to be carefully considered during the selection of the controls. So on the picture we see how the case control studies are conducted. At the present time we have the two groups, diseased and not diseased. So we go in the past and we check the exposure and risk factors. The advantages of the case studies are they are quicker and cheaper than cohort studies, so we will talk later about them. They are useful for the study of conditions which develop over the long period of time. They are useful for the study of disease of low prevalence, and we can study more than one determinant. The disadvantages are do not involve time sequence. They provide neither disease incidence nor prevalence. Rely on the quality of the records collected in the past, and they can study only one outcome because we group the animals by the outcome in the beginning. The cohort studies are form of longitudinal study which last over period of time, so we are introducing the factor time in the cohort studies that flows from the exposure to the outcome. The name cohort study came from the Roman military unit, the cohort, which was the basic military unit. So this unit cannot be divided, and it's also in the epidemiology term. We are in the beginning, we strictly defined the population, and there is no mixture between them. Neither they are allowing the new entries in strictly defined population. In a cohort study, a group exposed to a risk factor is compared with a group which are not in relation to disease development. It is then possible to calculate the level of risk of developing disease in relation to exposure to a risk factor. So the characteristics feature of the cohort study is that the subjects are identified at the point of time when they do not have the outcome of interest and compare the incidence of the outcome of the interest among groups of exposed and unexposed animal or less exposed subjects. Cohorts may be identified retrospectively or prospectively, but in either case the outcome status need to be established at least twice, in the beginning and on the end. It must be established that the cohort did not have the disease or outcome of interest at the beginning of observation period, and the cohort needs to be examined again to determine whether or not the outcome of subsequently developed or the incidence of each of the of exposure groups. The advantage of the cohort studies are that they provide information of the sequence of events when the disease occurred necessary for demonstrating causality. Provide incidence, the new cases of diseases, and they can study more than one outcome. The disadvantages, they are quite expensive and time consuming because they are required at least two, but most often the several visits to the farms. They are not suitable for disease of low incidence. They are suffering from withdrawal, so some animals might die, some animals might be sold, the farmers don't want to cooperate anymore, so it has to be calculated from the beginning that the cohort study lost its units over time. So in estimation the sample size, this has to be also taken in consideration. The sample size for a cohort must give some contingency part. They always have to be a little bit bigger than required because of those withdrawals. So also the disadvantage is that the exposure may change over time. So in if the cohort study lasts, let's say, over 1 year, the exposure time in the winter time and the summer time are not the same. So on the next two pictures, we can see the difference between the different type of studies. The first one, we have the difference with cohort and case control. The main difference between cohort and case control, because cohort starts at the present time with animals which do not have disease, and then we check the exposure and outcome. In case control study, we started with outcome and then go back in history to check the risk factors. The next picture, it's excellent explanation of different type of studies and which take also the time factor. So the cross-section study examined the present, and they measure the dispose and exposure simultaneously. The whole cohort study started with presence and measure the exposure, and we get the results in the future, which is disease or not. With case control study, we started with present and with disease, and we go and check the exposure in the past. Observational studies from the majority of epidemiological studies. Observational and experimental studies both have their strengths and weaknesses. A major advantage of the observational study that they explore the natural occurrence of disease. Experimental studies, from the other hand, may isolate the risk factor associated with disease from other risk factors that may be important interaction with them in the natural environment. On the following table, the strength and weaknesses for each different type of epidemiological studies are shown. So we have the advantages and disadvantages for cross-sectional, case control, and cohort study combined. Modeling is applied to many disciplines such as agriculture, meteorology, medicine, and of course in the veterinary profession. In epidemiology, models are designed to predict patterns of disease occurrence and what is likely to happen if different disease control measures or strategies are adopted. A model can be utilized effectively if it's based on valid assumptions or predictions. However, this is usually quite a difficult job. For example, it is almost impossible to estimate the successful contact rate of or transmission rate, which means the number of infected animals versus uninfected having been in contact with the infected one. However, there are three standard questions which has to be answered in order to avoid huge mistakes. The first one is, have all known determinants that influence disease occurrence have been included in the study? So we have to predict all possibilities which exist in nature. The death rate in uninfected animals, the birth rate, the movement patterns, trade patterns, vaccination, control, and so on. The next question is, can the value of these determinants be estimated with accuracy? So sometimes we have to check whether our computer model is following the events which happens in nature. And the third one, it's, does the model make the biological common sense? So when we design the model, we first design the model to express as much as possible the events which normally occur in nature. So, for example, if we design a disease model for cattle and we have reproduction rate of cattle in that model, which is close to the peaks, we will see that something is wrong with the model. Or if the death rates among the pigs is much higher than in nature, we will have to adjust the model. In addition, the extent to which changes in value of input parameters affect output parameters needs to be assessed by sensitivity analysis. If minor changes in values in input parameter induce major changes in the output parameters, then the model is highly sensitive to that input parameter. In contrary, if the major changes in input parameters induce only minor changes in output parameters, then the model is relatively insensitive for that parameter. The rapid development of information technology in the last few decades, in particular the increasing of the processor performances, enabled designing of quite complex modeling disease simulations. The computer models actually perform the same mathematical calculation used in veterinary epidemiology, but millions of them in each second. This enables the creation of quite complex disease modeling. The computer models can be designed for use on farm, national or international level. I forgot to mention that the modeling can be dynamic or static. In static, the parameters are given at the beginning of the model and they are not changing during the modeling. For example, we can give the death rate, reproduction rate, movement rates at the beginning. So the example of such a model is the FMDIS, which is model developed by FAO for simulation of FMDIS printing. The model uses real data, such as geographical distribution on farms of the country, number of animals of each farm, direct and indirect contacts, sanitary measures implemented, costs, and so on. The variables are changeable, for example, time for first occurrence, till first notification, percentage of contacts, summer, winter pattern, and so on, which enables comparison of effectiveness and financial resources required for disease control and eradication. The other models or dynamic models are using so-called real time. And they are similar with the science fiction movie Matrix, but with more science and less fiction. So, in other words, the model is simulating the real world. So we create the virtual world for certain population of animal. And the animals in this model are born, they are living, they have the mortality rates, they are suspicious for other disease other than disease of interest. And then in such environment, we can drop on a disease and see how disease is spread among the population. However, the models cannot stand alone in determining the efficient control strategies, but should be used in conjunction with accurate field data and experimental techniques. They can provide a useful means of investigating disease where experiments and field of the observations are impracticable or impossible. The good things in modeling and that we can run model hundreds of thousands of times and see which scenario it's more often happens in the model. So based on that, we cannot predict what could happen, but we cannot predict what might happen using the computer modeling. It's something difficult to establish a clear line between simple surveillance activities and actual disease control programs. Taking in the wider context, disease control includes all the various prophylactics and sanitary measures used with the objective of preventing the occurrence of disease, limiting its spread, and working toward eventual elimination. The aim of disease control activities is to reduce the prevalence of incidence of disease, where the purpose of surveillance and monitoring is to provide information which can be used by decision makers. Control activities include prophylactic measures such as vaccination, bleeding, and so on, or sanitary measures such as movement control or movement bans, quarantine, stamping house, disinfection, and so on, and treatment of infected animals, which includes treatment with antibiotics or antiparasitics. In order to be effective, disease control must be based on the good understanding of the current status of disease in question, which can be provided only by epidemiological surveillance and a knowledge of this its analytical epidemiology. However, to avoid introduction of disease in each country has its own import regulation. In European Union, those regulations are deducted from the official directives and regulation of the European Commission, such as Directive 2003 from 99 for the control of zoonosis, Regulation 429 2016, also known as the Animal Health Law, Regulation 2070-625 on official control, and so on. The OIE, from the other hand, informs the governments of the occurrence and course of animal diseases through the world and ways to control the disease. They coordinate the studies involving surveillance and control of animal disease, which can be applied to health regions of countries. Control strategies usually depend on the type of disease and of the available funds. Below are some possible action listed. First is do nothing. Sometimes it is possible to do nothing, whether the country has no enough financial resources for conducting control measures, or the control measures are more expensive than the impact of the disease. The other possibilities are movement restriction, quarantine, vaccination, medical treatment, improvement of biosecurity measures, which are in the recent years has more and more attention on the competent authorities. The next is disinfection, stamping out and slaughter, control and monitoring of vectors, risk management and follow-up measures, including monitoring and surveillance.